This video is part of my complete practical CCNA course where I'm showing you how to configure Cisco devices in preparation for the CCNA exam. Now it's your turn to set up root guard. I've created this topology of three switches. We've got switch one, switch two, and switch three. In this topology, switch three is the root bridge, has a priority of 4096. Switch one is the backup root with a priority of 8192, and switch three is using a default priority. So in other words, switch two is going to be the root in our topology. But what we're going to do in this topology is introduce an attacker switch. In this lab, you're going to connect switch two to the attacker switch and switch three to the attacker switch. This switch is going to be configured with a priority of zero, which means that it'll become the root bridge. That means that both this port and this port will be blocking, and traffic from PC1, as an example, will be sent through the attacker switch to PC3. That means that if you ran something like port mirroring or span, you as an attacker would see all the traffic sent from that PC to this PC, as well as all traffic from PC2, because the traffic would go via the switch. We've essentially blocked that port and blocked this port so that we have visibility of the traffic through the attacker switch. Now, we obviously want to stop that kind of nonsense, so we're going to want to enable root guard on switch 2, as well as switch 3 and switch 1. So that kind of information is given in the overview here, and then you're told to configure the attacker switch with a priority of 0 for VLAN 1, and then you're told to add the switch to the topology, and specific ports should be used for that. So connect gigabit 101 to switch 2 and gigabit 102 to switch 3, then verify that the attack has become the root in the network. Then you need to verify that when PC1 and PC2 ping PC3, the traffic ends up going through that switch, and hence an attacker could possibly see the traffic that they send in the network. Also note which interfaces are blocked on switch 3. So that shows the problem. And then here you need to solve it by enabling root guard on the switches. So on switch 2, you're going to do that on gigabit 101 to gigabit 1024. And on switch 3 and switch 1, gigabit 103 to gigabit 1024. So slight difference in the configuration of root guard on the switches. And now when you reconnect, and I didn't mention that, you need to remove the connections first before you enable root guard, so that when you connect the interfaces back again, you verify that root guard works. So in summary, you want to see what happens when you connect the switches to the attacker switch. Basically, this switch will become the root switch. But when you enable root guard on these two switches and you connect those ports back again, the switch will not become the root. Switch 2 will remain as the root bridge, and these ports will basically be blocked. Now, I always say this, the best way to learn is to do things yourself. So download the attached packet tracer file and try this yourself. If you want to see me complete it, continue watching, and I'll show you how to configure the switches and solve this problem. Okay, so now I'll complete the lab and hopefully teach you something new. Okay, so on switch 2, show spanning tree. What you can see here is the root has a priority of 4097. The local switch or bridge ID has a priority of 4097. So this switch is the root bridge. MAC address is the same for both. So that looks correct. What about switch one? So on switch one, show spanning tree. Root has a priority of 4097. Local switch has a priority of 8193. And again, just to remind you, it's 4097 and 8193 because we add one for the VLAN. So if I type show run pipe includes span, you can see the priority there is 8192. We're adding VLAN 1 to that to get 8193 because we're looking at VLAN 1. Same would be true on switch 2. Show run pipe include span. Priority is 4096. The switch hasn't had its priority changed. So on switch 3, show span. You can see priority is 32768 plus 1 for the VLAN number. So that kind of information is shown right there. So priority 32768 plus the extended system ID. And again, you see that over here, and you see that over here on switch one. Okay, so on the attacker switch, we need to configure the root priority to be 0 for VLAN 1. So on the attacker switch here, conft spanning tree, VLAN 1 priority is 0. So show spanning tree. At the moment, we're told that no instance exists, probably because no interfaces are up. All the interfaces are down at the moment. So what I'll do now is connect gigabit 104 to the first port on the switch per our instructions, and then connect 104 on switch 3 to the second port on the switch. Okay, so what you can see is spanning tree is trying to converge now. We can see the interfaces have gone up. Show spanning tree. You can see the interfaces are currently designated. It's learning. So it'll take a bit of time and then hopefully things will converge. But notice what's happening. A bunch of links are showing orange at the moment. Notice interface just went forwarding now. We've got two forwarding ports. And what you can notice here is the root ID priority is 1. This bridge is the root. Bridge ID is 1, priority of 0, plus extended system ID of 1. So the attacker switch is now the root switch. And what's interesting is notice this port is blocking and this port is blocking. So I put a cross here, but it's actually going to be on that port because it's further away. So this port is forwarding, that port is blocking in spanning tree. This port is blocking. We've now got this switch to be the root switch. Very nice that Packet Tracer shows us this visually. But net result is this interface is taken out of the topology. This interface is taken out of the topology. So I've verified that the attack has become the root bridge in the topology. We now need to verify that when PC1 and PC2 ping PC3, traffic is sent via the attacker switch. So what's the IP address of PC3? I'll type ipconfig. You can see the IP address is 192.168.1.3. So on PC1, can we ping that address? So ping 192.168.1.3. Ping succeed. But what I'm going to do now is enable simulation mode. And I'm going to uncheck all the options so we don't see all traffic and go edit filters. And the only filter we're going to use is ICMP. That's all I want to see. And now when we ping that PC, where does the traffic go? Okay, on my Mac, it's not showing this very nicely. It should show a nice envelope, but doesn't do it here for whatever reason. So what I'll do now is send the packet to the switch. You can see it goes to the switch and goes to that switch. So switch 2. And now notice it goes to the attacker switch and then goes to switch 3. So if I click on that little packet, we can see the different layers in the OSI model. We can see the inbound and outbound PDU. So we can see source IP address, destination IP address. So this is the IP address of PC1. This is the IP address of PC3. Important thing to note is the traffic is going from one PC to another through the attacker switch. So an attacker could basically get visibility into your traffic and could see what's going on. Okay, I'll just set that back to real time and let's do simulation mode again. And now on PC2, let's ping that address. So ping 192.168.1.3. Same thing again, packet looks horrible in my packet tracer, but hopefully the traffic will go to the attacker switch, which it does. And once again, when the reply comes back, the traffic is going via the attacker to PC2. If I ran span or port mirroring on the switch, I'd be able to see all your traffic. Okay, not great. So now we need to stop this nonsense. So first thing we need to do is remove the link from the attacker switch to switch 2 and switch 3. So I'll go to the top here and delete those two links. So spanning tree should reconverge now. While we're waiting for that, I'll enable root guard. So I'm going to enable root guard on ports gigabit 101 to 24 on switch 2. Show spanning tree. The switch has now become the root again, which is what we'd expect. And then we're going to type interface range gigabit 101 to 24. Spanning tree question mark guard root question mark enter. Show run. I've enabled root guard on all ports of the switch. On switch 3, we need to enable it on gigabit 103 to 1024. The reason why we don't want to enable it on all ports is this interface is connected to that switch. We don't want that port to be blocked. Conft interface range gigabit 103 to 24. Spanning tree root or guard root question mark enter. Okay, so I've enabled it on all interfaces apart from gigabit 101 and 102. And then on this switch, we'll do something similar. So conft interface range gigabit 103 to 24, spanning tree guard root. Now, what's going to happen when we connect to the attacker switch back to switch 2 and switch 3? So I'll connect that interface to the attacker switch, connect this interface to the attacker switch. On this switch, notice immediately we see a message. Interface has come up, line protocol has come up, but root guard block the port tried to become non-designated in VLAN 1, moved to root inconsistent state. So this is another example where spanning tree doesn't give us the exact correct information. Notice gigabit 104 showing as designated, and it's listening according to this. If I look at the detail of that port, so I'll scroll all the way down to port 4, notice we see it's an alternate port, path, cost information, and so forth is shown here. It's not giving us perfect information. So again, be careful with Packet Tracer. It's great for learning, but doesn't give you real-world information, hence me using physical switches, because that's real. Same thing here. We see that it's moved to the root inconsistent state, root guard block showing here. So shows spanning tree. This port, according to Packet Tracer, is in the listening state. If we look at detail and go down, we can see that it's now designated according to this output. So again, not perfect. But the point is notice these two ports are blocking, and notice show spanning tree on switch 2. The switch has remained as the root switch. So our topology hasn't been affected by that attacker switch being added to the topology. What about packets when PC1 pings PC3 again? In simulation mode, we can see that the packet goes to switch 2. It actually gets copied to switch 3 as well here, but gets dropped because of the blocking port. Notice the traffic goes here. It's interesting that it does that. That's probably because the MAC address tables need to be populated. But notice the traffic doesn't go to the attacker switch. It goes between the switches, not to the attacker switch. So if I continue that process, traffic is sent from switch 2 to switch 3, not to the attacker switch. So the attacker switch doesn't get to see the traffic, and it's actually been removed from the topology. Okay, I'll go back to real time. On PC2 now, I'll ping that again. Actually, I need to set that to simulation mode first. So let's do that again. Now ping, traffic goes to switch 2, goes to switch 3, goes to PC3, doesn't go to the attacker switch. So that looks better. Okay, so there we go. We verified that root guard works in the topology. I'm happy with that. Did you manage to complete the lab? Hopefully you did. Packet Tracer is great, but it's not perfect. Here's one more example of why I like it and don't like it. I'm David Bumble, and I want to wish you all the very best.